morning and welcome. Glad that you're here this morning. My name is Dan Thompson. I serve as one of the pastors here at St. Paul's, and it's our joy to welcome you to this worship service. If you're visiting with us today, we're glad you're here. On the back page of your liturgy, you'll find a note that includes the email address that you can contact, use to contact us to let us know your name and any information you'd like to give us. You can also ask questions about the church, and you can give us prayer requests. The staff meets every Tuesday and prays for the prayer requests that are submitted, so we invite you to do that. But also encourage you, if you're visiting, to introduce yourself to one of the pastors or to one of the elders or one of the ushers, and we'd like to welcome you. I know it feels really different to come and not be able to welcome people like we usually do because of face masks. Sometimes you can't tell, is that somebody I know or somebody I don't know? But encourage you still to welcome people and reach out to them. A couple of announcements. This coming Friday night and Saturday morning, we will have a newcomers class. If you're new to the church and would like more information about who we are as a church, what we believe, and why we do things the way we do, we invite you to come. It's a casual meal will be served Friday night. If you plan to attend, we need you to RSVP. And if you would like childcare, we need to know by tomorrow. So if you would contact the church office to let us know, we'd be glad to help arrange that. Also want to announce that we have a new home group that started this past week at Andrew and Deandra Auer's home in Maitland. Fredo Perez is facilitating. They're meeting twice a month on Wednesdays. If you'd like to participate, you can contact Fredo or Andrew or Deandra, and they'd be glad to help you connect with that group. Deandra's eyes go like this. Don't everybody come all at once, but they would like to let it be known so that people can participate in that group. I do want to thank all of you who helped yesterday with the workday. We were able to go to several different projects and had a lot of people coming out to help. As an expression of love to people who can't do some of those things for themselves, it's a great way to reach out and love our neighbors. So thank you all for helping with that. I'll mention next Sunday evening, we will have a Reformation service, and we'll be doing a joint service with the congregation that Mike Aitchison, Christ United Fellowship. I know that, but anyway, we'd love to have you participate Sunday evening next week. And then one announcement, the Swansons will be returning this week on Tuesday to France. They would like to have been here today for us to commission them officially, but because they have to be able to get on a plane on Tuesday and test negative for COVID, it's expedient for them to not be around anybody. So they are at home. They're participating online, so welcome to you all. Just to let you know, the Swansons serve in France. They've just been recently reassigned and will be going to Paris. There were some issues in getting back that had to do with the COVID shutdown there, but also with a visa issue for Joel particularly. That has been cleared up as long as they get back to France before October 30, so they are leaving hopefully on Tuesday, Lord willing on Tuesday, and have asked us if we would pray for them. So let's do that. We'll pray for Joel and Stephanie and Pascal. Just remind you also to keep that church in your prayers. They've been assigned to work with the church. During the time they've not been able to be there, the pastor died in a tragic accident. The assistant pastor, Mark Etienne, and Elder Nicholas are caring for this grieving congregation, and they're anxious for the Swansons to get there. So let's do lift them up in prayer. It's been a blessing, you guys, to be able to have you here speaking to the Swansons for these months and to be able to participate with us. I know they were gone a lot of weekends visiting different churches, but we've been able to enjoy their fellowship during this time that they've been at home. So let's take just a moment right now to pray for them. Father, we pray for Joel and Stephanie and Pascal in this new assignment. We pray that when they get on the plane on Tuesday, they would be able to board, that there would be no COVID issues. We also pray that there would be no difficulties with the visa that's been granted, that they would be able to travel safely. We are excited for the new opportunity you have opened up for them. We do pray for the church that they'll be coming alongside to assist and ask that you would bless that church and strengthen it and use the Swansons to minister to many in the city of Paris and the suburb where they will be going. Thank you for the time that they've been able to be here. Thank you for them as a family and for the blessing they've been to us. And we ask your blessing on them now as they step out to this task to which you've called them. May they go with your peace and with your blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, our vision here at St. Paul's is to see the invisible kingdom of heaven made visible for the glory of God and for the joy of all peoples. So one of the ways that we do that is to gather together in the communion of the saints, to gather with other believers, to join our hearts in praise to God. In a sense, when we come, we're coming to worship before an audience of one. God is the audience in worship. You are not. But we are like the actors in a play, and part of what we do as we sing together, as we go through the liturgy, is to encourage one another to say these things and to affirm these beliefs again. So brothers and sisters, would you prepare your hearts to worship God? Grace to you, and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was, and is to come. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. Amen. Let's stand as we give praise to the Lord together.
Amen. Hallelujah. Let's continue to pray to our Lord. Pray with me. Almighty and everlasting God, in Christ you have revealed your glory among the nations. Preserve the works of your mercy, that your church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Friends, please hear the reading of God's word from Deuteronomy 10, verses 12 to chapter 11, verse 1. The reading of the Old Testament. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you? But to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to keep the commandments and statutes of the Lord, which I am commanding you today for your good. Behold, to the Lord your God belong heaven and the heaven of heavens, the earth with all that is in it. Yet the Lord set his heart in love on your fathers and chose their offspring after them, you above all peoples, as you are this day. Circumcise, therefore, the foreskin of your heart, and be no longer stubborn. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great, the mighty, and the awesome God, who is not partial and takes no bribe. He executes justice for the fatherless and the widow, and loves the sojourner, giving him food and clothing. Love the sojourner, therefore, for you were sojourners in the land of Egypt. You shall fear the Lord your God. You shall serve him and hold fast to him, and by his name you shall swear. He is your praise. He is your God. He has done for you these great and terrifying things that your eyes have seen. Your fathers went down to Egypt, 70 persons, and now the Lord your God has made you as numerous as the stars of heaven. You shall therefore love the Lord your God and keep his charge, his statutes, his rules, and his commandments always. The word of the Lord.
This time I invite you to kneel as we go before the Lord in confession. Martin Luther, reformer, in the first of his 95 theses said, when our Lord and Master Jesus Christ said, repent, he willed the entire life of believers to be one of repentance. Confession is part of repentance. It's acknowledging our sin before the Lord and acknowledging our need for God to change our hearts. Let's confess our sins first together and then silently individually. Would you join me? Our Father in heaven, in your holy presence, we confess our sin. To know you and your Son, Jesus Christ, is eternal life. And yet we have sought life in the short-lived goods and fleeting pleasures of this world. You are the one true and living God, and yet we have not been singularly devoted to you. You have revealed your glory through the selfless way of the cross, and yet we have sought our own glory by way of pride and self-promotion. You have made us one through the gift of your Son, and yet we have failed to pursue that unity in the bonds of peace. Therefore, we repent and pray that you would forgive us in Jesus' name and give us strength to live changed lives by the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. And would you please take a moment to silently confess your sin to the Lord? Brothers and sisters, hear this good news. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As the Father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Let's continue to pray together. Father, we praise you. You have made yourself known to us as a God of mercy and grace, a God of tenderness and compassion. Through Jesus Christ, you've taught us to call you Father. And you've shown us the intimacy of relationship you want with your people. You have loved us with an everlasting love. You've sent your Son to give himself in our place, to bear the punishment we deserve, that we might be set free from the condemnation and penalty of sin. You have lavished upon us grace upon grace. You have given us your Spirit. We praise you for your goodness to us, and we thank you for your saving grace in our lives. We thank you for the gifts that you have lavished upon your people. We thank you for the gifts that you have given to this church family in the form of people who serve in so many different ways. Thank you for service that is rendered to you that benefits the body. We thank you for caring for our needs. We thank you for preserving us. Father, we ask as we come before you and set our petitions before you, we ask that you would open our eyes to understand more clearly who you are and what it means to belong to you by grace. Open our hearts to you. Thank you for the work of your Spirit who draws us to Christ and continues to pursue us and draw us increasingly to follow you and to love you and to delight in you. Would you deepen our love for you and our love for one another? Would you preserve and sustain your people, your church, for Jesus' sake? We ask in his name, amen.
This morning we have the privilege to join generations of Christians around the world in confessing our faith using the Nicene Creed. The Nicene Creed was written primarily as the church was wrestling with the question, who is Jesus Christ? And what does the Word teach about who Jesus is? It's absolutely important for us to know who Jesus is and how we understand him according to the scriptures. And so let's join those generations of Christians this morning around the world as well as we confess who Jesus Christ is, who God is in Christ. Join me in this affirmation of faith. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And we believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Scripture reading this morning from the New Testament comes from Paul's letter to the Philippians. We are in chapter 3, and just to remind you of the context for the passage we'll be looking at, in chapter 3, Paul begins to lay bare his heart to these people, describing how he had at one time relied on an impeccable heritage as a Hebrew of Hebrews, and on his own efforts to obey the law as the basis for considering himself righteous or right legally before God. But then God intervened and changed his heart, and Paul writes, "But whatever gain I had, I count as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. And our reading this morning picks up at verse 12. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who are mature think this way, and if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you. Only let us hold true to what we have attained. Brothers, join in imitating me, and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. For many of whom I have often told you, and now tell you, even with tears, walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their end is destruction. Their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame with minds set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we ask that your Spirit, who inspired these words of Scripture through the Apostle Paul, would now be our teacher. Would you open our eyes to see things in this passage that you want us to see, and would you open our hearts to be receptive to what you say to us? Like water that's poured over a jar with a lid on it, does no good unless the lid is taken off and opened up. So the message of the gospel does us no good unless you, by your Spirit, open our hearts to receive it. So would you do that work in us today? We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Someone texted me on Friday or Thursday and said, hey, did you realize that the sermon text and outline for today is the same as the one that was in the bulletin a few weeks ago? I said, yeah, that's because I got a real bad cold on Saturday and Mike Glotto filled in for me, and we're preaching through Philippians, so I can't skip over it, so we're going to cover it, that passage, today. Appreciate Mike stepping in at the last minute, but I'm really glad to be with you today. This is a wonderful passage of Scripture, so let's look at it. I don't remember how many years ago, but my wife was given a set of silver place settings by her mother. You know, knives, forks, and spoons, they're beautiful. They had her family initial on the handles. And while I wasn't meaning to be picky, I noticed that some of the table knives had the tips badly bent. And I asked Margaret, how did that happen? And she said, oh, my dad used them as screwdrivers. You know, not surprisingly, a silver table knife makes a terrible screwdriver, just like a screwdriver would make a terrible table knife. A table knife has a purpose, and a screwdriver has a purpose, and their purposes are not one and the same. The Greek word telos, T-E-L-O-S, means end, or purpose, or goal. That word is there in verse 19 when Paul says their end. He uses the word telos. Their telos is destruction. Greek philosophers used the word telos to describe a purpose or a direction that something was heading. Something is made for a purpose, it's made for a certain end, and it's made to accomplish a specific goal. Well, you know what the purpose of a table knife is. Its telos is pretty clear. It's for cutting light things like ham or turkey, spreading a little butter on a roll. But what about human beings? Do people have a telos? Were we made for a purpose or for an end goal? What is the purpose, the telos, of a human being? You actually know the answer to this question if I just ask it a little bit differently. What is man's chief end? That's a teleological question. Telos plus logos, the study of ends or purposes. What is man's chief end? To glorify God and enjoy him forever. Or as John Piper puts it, to glorify God by enjoying him forever. You know, I don't care whether or not you remember the word telos. What's more important is that you understand this truth. God has made us for a purpose. He saved us for a purpose. We are headed toward an end, and that end gives meaning to all of life. Again, verse 19, their end is destruction. He's saying the trajectory of a life lived apart from God is death. eternal separation from God, with all that that means. That's their final destination. That's where people end up without a Savior. It's like a knife that is used for a purpose for which it was not intended. Man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. When a person does not glorify or enjoy God, it's tragic, which is why Paul says, he says these things with tears. When Jesus said the Son of Man came to seek and save that which was lost, He was saying something about human beings in their lostness. They need saving. It's kind of like if you find a silver table knife in a tool chest, that knife needs saving. It needs to be returned to the silverware drawer. When Jesus saves a person, He restores a human being to the purpose for which He created human beings. We were made to be creatures that bring glory to God and that have a unique capacity to enjoy relationship with God. As I read this part of Philippians 3, I was reminded of something that Archibald Alexander said in his little booklet, Aging in Grace, a wonderful collection of four letters that he wrote to aging church members in the congregation he pastored. Archibald Alexander died in 1851. He was a Presbyterian pastor and theologian. He served as the first professor of theology at Princeton Seminary. Here's what he said. The whole evidence of Christian character may be reduced to two particulars. Now, I'm always a little suspicious, skeptical of statements that say everything can be boiled down to this one thing. But in this case, I think he's right. The whole of the Christian life, all that it means to be a Christian, the whole evidence of Christian character may be reduced to two particulars. Entire trust in Christ for justification, and a sincere and universal love of holiness with a dependence on the Holy Spirit for its existence, continuance, and increase. What I've given you on your outline is the big idea for the sermon is obviously, therefore, not original, right? I just paraphrased what Archibald Alexander said. Embracing God's saving purposes can be summarized in two specifics. First, a joyful trust in Christ alone as the ground of your justification, and second, a sincere desire for holiness in every area of life. And if you want to know, what is Paul talking about in Philippians chapter 3? This is what he's talking about, these two ideas. What does it mean to rest in your justification in Christ alone, and what does it mean to be drawn toward holiness by the work of God's Spirit? Jesus died to win your freedom. In our call to worship this morning, we used a part of the book of Revelation, to Him who loves us and has freed us from our sins. Jesus frees us from our sins in His saving work. He frees us from the penalty of our sin, that's justification. He frees us from the reigning power, the controlling power of sin, that's His work of sanctification or increasing holiness in us. And He will save us in the end from the very presence of sin. That will be glorification. And all of that comes into this passage. So let's look first at joyful trust in Christ alone as the ground of our justification, or an entire trust in Christ, a complete trust in Christ and nothing else for justification. Paul says in chapter 3, verse 8, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith. He's describing justification. It's a legal term, to be set free from the penalty of sin, to be pardoned. God's grace that justifies sinners is a settled matter because it doesn't depend on us. It depends on what God has done in Jesus. The gospel describes an exchange. Our unrighteousness, our guilt, is laid on Jesus, and He suffers the death that we deserve. He takes the punishment that we deserve on Himself on the cross. And in turn, He credits to us a righteousness that we have not earned, that we didn't accomplish, His own righteousness, His own perfect holiness, as though we had lived this way before God. God counts a sinner as righteous in His sight when He credits the righteousness of Jesus to a sinner. That's justification. You can't be more justified tomorrow than you are today. You can understand your justification better. You can rest in your justification more tomorrow than you do today. But because justification is not something you accomplish, but something God does, all you can do is receive it and rest in it. That receiving and resting should produce fruit in our lives. I mean, think of it. If you live with a dreadful fear that you will be condemned when you stand before God on the day of judgment, if you think you must do something more try harder, do more to earn the righteousness you need before God, that's going to shape the way you approach God. There was a time when Luther said, love God, sometimes I hate God. Now, he was trying to earn justification and he knew he couldn't do it. He kept falling short. It'd be like trying to please a parent whose love is conditional. You never measure up. You never get it right. You're never able to please. You end up discouraged and angry instead of being drawn toward that parent in relationship. There's a distance that's created. Well, if you imagine your justification depends on what you do and you know yourself at all, you're going to know that you're always falling short, you're never measuring up, and you will not live with joy before God. If you are united to Jesus Christ by faith, as far as your legal standing before God is concerned, justice is satisfied. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Paul warned in the earlier part of chapter 3, he warned the Philippians to watch out for the dogs, the Judaizers who preached a message of faith in Christ plus circumcision, probably plus Jewish dietary laws. Why did he tell them to watch out for that? Well, what they were offering was a different religion. It was not the gospel of God's free grace in Christ Jesus. It was a man-centered, works righteousness religion. And he says, don't pay attention to that. Don't listen to it. Watch out for it. Why? Because it will rob you of joy. It will leave you feeling unloved and distant from God. Jesus died to save you from the guilt, the condemnation, the penalty of your sin. So believe the gospel and rest in the finished work of Jesus. And don't let anyone convince you that what Jesus did for you in his suffering and death on the cross is not enough, that you have to somehow add to it to be right with God. So that's first. Embracing God's saving purposes can be summarized in two specifics. First, joyful trust in Christ alone as the ground of your justification. But that's not all there is to the gospel. Because God loves us, he is not satisfied with just a legal pronouncement of pardon. You know, the truth is, sin is a cruel master. The saving work of God aims at setting us free from the controlling power of sin. And God's promise in Christ is that we will be set free someday from the very presence of sin. All that sin does to harm and distort and destroy will someday no longer be part of our experience. So embracing God's saving purposes does not stop with justification. It includes that second point, a sincere desire for holiness in every area of life. Or as Archibald Alexander put it, a sincere and universal love of holiness with a dependence on the Holy Spirit for its existence, continuance, and increase. A universal love of holiness means a whole life. All of who you are desire for holiness. And by holiness, I mean an increasing experience of freedom from the controlling power of sin in your experience. All growth in holiness is in dependence on the Holy Spirit. It's not something you stir up in yourself or by your own goodness or accomplished by your hard work. You grow in godliness and Christ's likeness because God is at work in you. As Paul said earlier in his letter, God is at work in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. Think of it, that there is any holiness in you at all is because God's Spirit is at work, changing what you want, changing your opinion of the goodness of God's commandments, and sustaining that desire and causing it to increase the longer you walk with Jesus. In Christ, we are given a new end, a new telos, a new purpose, a new goal or objective. So the trajectory of a life lived in union with Jesus Christ is toward all that the Bible means by the word life and all that it means by the word holiness. When Jesus said, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly, he came to give us life in the richest sense of that word, setting us free from everything that distorts all that life was intended to be in creation. He didn't come to give us a happy, abundant life as we tend to define happy and abundant, you know, trouble-free, lots of stuff until you die and then you go to heaven. No, he came to give us life, give us new direction, a new hope, a new goal, a new meaning and purpose in life. He came to enable us to glorify God and enjoy him forever. Paul's confident trust in Christ for justification is clear, but there's more that he longs for. He is not yet what he knows Jesus saved him to be. Lest anyone think he's claiming to have arrived already, he says, verse 12, not that I have already obtained all this or am already made perfect. This is the only time in Paul's letters that he uses this word perfect, and some scholars suggest the word is borrowed from ancient mystery religions of that time that offered devoted followers a secret that would enable them to attain perfection in this life. And Paul is denying that. He's saying, not that I have obtained perfection, as some people vainly imagine they have. He's saying, I'm not there yet, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Now, that's an amazing phrase in itself, isn't it? Christ Jesus took hold of me. Not that I've already obtained this or I'm already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Now, the imagery is obvious. A runner in a race does not keep on looking back. He strains forward to the tape. And whether Paul says, I press on, meaning, you know, I'm not looking back at past failures or past successes, what he's clear on is that his focus is on what lies ahead. One thing I do. A runner in a race can't be distracted by a lot of things. He has to keep focused on the goal. His eye is on the prize. There is a telos in a race. There's a finish line. A runner has a destination. The Christian life can be described as a race. We are running a race, and there is an end. There is a finish line, a purpose for which God saved us. And the more we're able to keep our focus on what lies ahead, the more it will shape our lives, the way we live, the whole of our lives. A runner who wants to win forgets what lies behind. He forgets how far he's come. He forgets how well or how poorly he has run so far, and he strains with all his energy and determination toward the finish line. In the Christian life, all kinds of things distract us and divert attention from the focus on the finish line, right? In a book called A Long Obedience in the Same Direction, Eugene Peterson said, our attention spans have been conditioned by 30-second commercials. Our sense of reality has been flattened to 30-page abridgments. It is not difficult in such a world to get a person interested in the message of the gospel. It is terrifically difficult to sustain that interest. Millions of people in our culture make decisions for Christ, but there is a dreadful attrition rate. In our kind of culture, anything, even good news about God, can be sold if it is packaged freshly. But when it loses its novelty, it goes on the garbage heap. There is a great market for religious experience in our world, but there is little enthusiasm for the patient acquisition of virtue, little inclination to sign up for a long apprenticeship in what earlier generations of Christians called holiness. You know, maybe that's because Christians don't often consider or keep in mind the finish line, the end, the purpose for which Christ saved us. Paul says, one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind, and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Now, this is the glory of the gospel. God has called us heavenward. He has promised us an eternal homeland in which all that sin does to distort and destroy in our present experience will be removed forever. And when you consider what is coming, the logical response is to press on toward that goal, to live your life with that destination in view. The finish line is not perfection achieved somewhere along the line before you die. The finish line is not even death. The finish line is beyond death when we see God face to face, when we will finally be free to fully delight our hearts in God Himself. Paul says in verse 15, let those of us who are mature think this way, and if in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you, only let us hold true to what we have attained. This is how we should look at life. This is how we should approach life. Maturity as a Christian means living in a manner consistent with who you are in union with Jesus Christ. Verse 17, join with others in following my example, brothers, and take note of those who live according to the pattern we gave you. He's not saying, I am the very model of a modern major general, or something like that. You know, I'm the very model of a mature Christian man. That's not what he's saying. But he is a model of single-minded devotion to Jesus Christ. He is a model of a man who is striving toward the goal. He hasn't reached it yet, but he's diligently pursuing it. And when he wrote this letter, he was much closer to the finish line than he had been. That's the kind of person we are to imitate. Not someone who pretends that he has arrived, but someone who is a model of humility and zeal, who is focused on pursuing Jesus with his whole heart. Christianity is not just a set of facts to know, it's a life to be lived, it's a race to be run, and we need examples to show us how to run that race well and how to live that life well. Verse 18 and 19 sets up a contrast, for as many as I have often told you before and now say again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction, their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is on earthly things. And who does he have in mind? It's probably the same group that he had in mind as we were talking earlier in the chapter about those dogs, those mutilators of the flesh, the ones who were distorting the gospel. Because their basis for confidence before God was themselves, their own goodness, the things that they did to make themselves right with God. Their confidence was horribly misplaced. But what does he mean, their God is their stomach? It sounds kind of personal. If he has in mind the Judaizers, by pushing Jewish ceremonial law on Gentile converts as a requirement for justification, Paul is saying they distort and deny the gospel. It could be, Paul is saying, in their pressing Jewish dietary laws on people, they are obsessed with laws related to food. Their God, their religion has become their stomachs. Moises Silva, in his commentary on Philippians, says, no, the noun here, stomach, designates the lower cavity of the body, what other people, some translations call the bowels of affection, that kind of thing in older translations, which were seen in the ancient world as the seat of a person's driving affections. So it would be closely tied to what we mean when we talk about the heart. That's the seat of your passions, your desires, your drives, and your motives. If that's what Paul means, then he's saying their God is their desires. And he uses this word to describe earthly-minded impulses, virtually saying the same thing as they are governed by the flesh. In contrast to being governed by God's Spirit, they are governed by a fleshly, a worldly mindset. Their frame of mind is opposed to the Spirit of God, and it shows up in a variety of misplaced confidences. Their glory, he says, is their shame, that which they take such pride in, the righteousness they imagine they have through rule-keeping, will be their source of shame when they stand before God on the day of judgment. They put all their hope and confidence in things that can't earn them anything before God. And here's the contrast, verse 20. But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. Our citizenship is in heaven. Citizen is a political term. The Greek root word here is actually polis. It's where we get our word political or politics. It refers to a city or state. Is the gospel political? Well, that depends entirely on what you mean. But in the deepest sense of the word political, yes, the gospel is absolutely political because it has to do with your citizenship. It identifies citizenship. It defines which city-state you ultimately belong to. We think of politics in terms of being an American citizen or a Florida citizen or a citizen of Orlando. We think of politics in terms of being a Republican or Democrat or liberal or conservative or whatever. We are part of American culture, and good citizenship requires participation in a political process. But in all the rhetoric and all the political ads and campaign sound bites and party posturing, don't lose sight of who you are. Our citizenship is in heaven. Our political reality is that we belong to a different city, a city that is not a part of this world. When you were united to Christ, you were transferred from the domain of darkness and delivered into the kingdom of the Son of God. Your name is listed in the register of those who belong to the kingdom of God. You have a king. So who are you? It's not defined by allegiance to a political party in America. It's defined by allegiance, above all, to your King, Jesus. Our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, from heaven, the Lord Jesus Christ. You ever think about the second coming of Jesus and kind of dread that? Like if Jesus came back today, would you say, bad timing, Jesus? There were so many things I wanted to do, and you've ruined my life because I won't get to do those things. Not at all. We eagerly await his coming. Why? Well, it has to do with our telos, our end, or our purpose. Who, by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. His glorious body is kind of shorthand for his person, all that Jesus is. The hope that we have is not just that someday we'll be raised to life as Jesus was raised to life in a body that's no longer capable of suffering or dying. You know, that's part of it, but our hope in Christ actually runs deeper than that. There is a longing that drives the people of God. It's a statement in the Westminster Larger Catechism. It's question 86. It says roughly this: what is the communion in glory with Christ which the members of the invisible church enjoy immediately after death? What is communion in glory with Christ which the members of the invisible church, those who truly belong to Jesus, enjoy immediately after death? And here's the answer: the communion in glory with Christ which the members of the invisible church enjoy immediately after death is their souls are then made perfect in holiness and received into the highest heavens, where they behold the face of God in light and glory. That's the finish line. That's where the race ends up. We will be made perfect in holiness, received into the highest heavens, and we will see God face to face. We will behold the face of God in light and glory. Yes, he will transform our lowly bodies. We eagerly await the resurrection of our bodies. We eagerly await the complete restoration of creation. We will be raised in power, in bodies that are no longer capable of suffering or dying, incorruptible like his glorious body. You and I will be changed, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15. The mortal will put on immortality. The perishable will be made imperishable, no longer able to die. But brothers and sisters, the greatest change, the change that should pull your heart heavenward, is that then you will no longer be sinful. There will be no more of the treason in our hearts that so grieves us now, the stuff that we have to confess day after day and week after week as we come before God in worship. That will be gone. We will be made like Jesus in righteousness. We will finally be made perfect in holiness and received into the highest heavens, where we will behold the face of God in light and glory. Paul comes to this conclusion: therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. You want a foundation for standing firm no matter what life will throw at you? Here it is. Consider the finish line. Consider where the race is headed. Sometimes it feels like we in our country are facing a crisis point. It feels like the world as we know it could radically change. It feels like no matter who wins the presidential election in a couple of weeks or few weeks, there will be a deep political unrest and division. I mean, you can hear fear in people's conversations. You hear it in the campaign ads. You hear the longing for someone to restore some level of sanity and bring peace to a divided populace. You see, where do you get the courage to stand firm against all the uncertainty and unrest? Where do you find the courage to stand firm in the face of the griefs and disappointments of life in this present world, the stuff that you're going through, the stuff you have to handle? Where do you get the courage to stand firm against all the opinions that come against your trust in God's word? Well, the truth of who you are in union with Jesus Christ is the foundation for courage, for standing firm. You are a citizen of heaven. You have a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Your Savior is all-powerful. He will bring everything under his control. The day is coming, may it come quickly, when we are finally set free completely from the sin in our own hearts and from the sin that distorts our world. Knowing what lies ahead, let's stand firm in the Lord Jesus as dearly loved children of God, and let's run the race that's been set before us, thinking about the finish line. Let that finish line and what you will enjoy when you see God face to face shape the way you live now. Let's pray together. Father, we praise you for the glory of the gospel of your grace in Jesus Christ. What an amazing message. We have a Savior who cares about our freedom. We are captive to sin and without hope apart from God. Jesus came into this world to be our substitute in punishment, to bear the wrath that we deserve, that we might be set free from the penalty of our sin. We also are held captive to sin in the way we live every day. The Bible tells us we're no longer slaves to sin, but in our experience it often feels like we can't control the choices that we make. Our Savior cares that we be set free from the controlling power of sin, and you have given us, Lord Jesus, new hearts, You've given us your Spirit to change our desires. Little by little, you are drawing us toward the end line, the goal of conformity to Jesus Christ. Would you do that work more powerfully in us? And we long for the day when you set us free completely from the very presence of sin. You've given us your promises that are secure and firm, that this world will be remade. No longer will there be any death. Tears won't be necessary. There'll be no more suffering, no more sin. We long for that day. Lord Jesus, enable us to live in light of that day that is coming, lives that are pleasing to you. Enable us to rest in our justification and to pursue holiness and dependence on your Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, at this time, the Lord invites us to give of our tithes and offerings to the Lord. As we continue to persevere in this life, we have the opportunity of responding to God with gratitude by giving to the church for the extension of the kingdom of God around the world. Please do be seated at this time. And we invite you to give after the service in the plates at the back of the room, or give online since we're not passing the plates at this time. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, we worship you and we praise you today. We lift your name on high. We pray that you would enable us to be a faithful people, to persevere well, that we would finish well, that we would run the race set out for us and bring all glory and honor to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And these gifts that you have given us, that we give back to you today, would you use them for the extension of his kingdom in all the nations, that Jesus may be worshiped and glorified, that all knees would bow before him and proclaim that Jesus reigns. We pray these things in his name and for his glory. Amen.
Now receive God's blessing. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Now go in peace to love and serve the risen Lord Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
And friends, please do wait to be dismissed by the ushers as they dismiss your row.